John Messina, and welcome to another edition of Hey Coach. We have a special guest with us tonight, a good friend of mine, Rob Murphy, former Major League pitcher, graduate of Columbus High School in Miami. Welcome, Rob.
Thank you, John. Okay. Appreciate you having me.
Oh, it's great. I know we talk about baseball and we talk about athletics all the time, and I wanted to bring you on the show and get your valuable input on that. A little bit about your background, Rob.
I grew up in Miami. Went to Miami Columbus High School, arch rival of Miami Pace High School.
Yes, yeah.
Your old stomping grounds.
Yes.
And then I went to the University of Florida for a couple years.
Right.
I was drafted by the Cincinnati Reds in the first round of the January draft in 1981.
Okay.
Played through 5 years in the minor leagues, and then I was very fortunate to have played in the major leagues from 1985 to 1995.
How was that in the minors, going way back then? I mean, I know the minors is still tough,
mm-hmm.
but it had to be even tougher going way back then. I mean, you know, with your salaries and going on the bus trips and everything. And
The minor league minimum at that point in time was $600 a month. So the
wow.
net take home was $119 a week. And it made it tough to stretch that out,
right.
you know, to get week by week to get
right.
the paycheck. It was something that I just took as a life lesson. And it's like, you know, it can get better
yeah.
if you rise up and work yeah. at your craft. So it was definitely the carrot in front of me that kept me driving.
You didn't get per diem money, I would think, right? Or did you get a little bit? Or
on the road, we got yeah. $10 or $11 a day.
That's
so
it was thinking of $10 or $11
yeah.
a day.
And,
right?
and when we would go on the road, let's say my second year when I was in the
yeah.
Midwest League, in Beloit, Wisconsin.
Wow.
There was a truck stop across the street from our hotel where you could get two chicken strips, mashed potatoes and gravy for $2.
Wow.
So our whole team went there for breakfast, lunch, and dinner.
Wow. As you got into the majors, who had the biggest influence on you, coaching-wise?
Immediately, I mean, I had such great fortune yeah. to have had some amazing coaches and some incredible teammates.
Yeah.
I mean, my first manager was Pete Rose.
Wow.
And I came up 10 days before he okay. had broken Ty Cobb's all-time hit
right.
record. So the media attention was crazy, and it was almost like a circus because 300 members of the media in the locker room as opposed to the normal four or five
right.
beat writers. But Pete's relentless focus on his team's games day after day and his at-bats, you know, three, four, or five every game. It was amazing to watch and realize he could work through all this noise and focus on what was necessary.
Right.
My first pitching coach in big leagues was Jim Cott, a local Treasure
right.
Coast
right.
Resident.
Right.
And if you just sat near Jim, you would learn so much day to day about baseball. It wasn't like the teacher at the chalkboard writing stuff down and saying, memorize this. It was
right.
just, it was the story of baseball and how to learn it.
And listening, which is something I think, you know, a lot of our athletes now, you know, I my pet peeve is when we're coaching and the first thing kids come out and say, I know. Well, you don't know because that's why we're explaining that to you, but that's a little bit different. Now, did you play on the Reds when Lenny Harris was there?
I was a teammate of Lenny
okay,
Harris,
so.
And he was one of my favorite teammates.
Okay.
He was a guy that always kept you in good spirits,
right.
and it was, you know, baseball was his whole life.
Right.
And seeing him make it to the major leagues and be successful
right.
for a long time was really
right.
nice to see.
I got to know Lenny when he played for Miami Jackson with Rafael Palmeiro, and I'm coaching third, and Lenny's, I'm coaching third, and Lenny's playing third. He never shut up the whole game. I mean, we knew each other's, you know, inside and outside, and we became pretty close afterwards. Lenny always came over when he made it to the majors, helped us at Pace. Then when Centennial hosted the state championships, baseball championships, Lenny came up, and, you know, he was working out. He went to see Ricky Gutierrez, who played for the Red Sox and played for American High School.
Mm-hmm.
But Lenny's just a credit given back, and he has done just a great career through there. Baseball in the 70s and the 80s and the 90s in Miami was a little bit different. Okay, back then there was only four classifications. There's nine now. Now I know there's more schools, but there's not that many more schools. So just the quality of baseball back then, can you elaborate on that in high school?
You know, we had a lot of teams in our district back then. Now I know, you know, having coached in the local high school area. You know, you'll have a lot of four-team districts.
Yeah.
And you'll have maybe one or two good teams. You'll have a mid-rung team and then a team that's at the bottom. Where in the GMAC, we played a lot of district games. And it seemed like almost every game was a district game. And it wasn't, I noticed that now there's the high and the low. Oh, it's a district game, get up for it.
Yes.
You had to be up for every game back then because every opponent was top-notch. And even non-conference opponents, like when Miami played Pace or we traveled to Tampa to play Tampa Catholic, those games, it was on from the first pitch.
Right. And you know, back then you were playing 30 games, which now we're down to 25, you know, in most counties back then. And we always played in an 18 district, and only one team advanced. So you had to win. Now you're playing a 14 district or a 3-team district, and two teams advance. And it's, you know, it doesn't have the influence, as you mentioned before. You know, some of the great players that came out of Miami, you know, player after player after player, you know, now I think it's a little more diversified through the state. I think, you know, Miami had a certain hold on the state baseball tournament. I know now it has shifted to football, which is the dominant sport down there. As you grew and you left the major league, what made you get into high school coaching?
Coaching in general was something that I'd been asked for years and years. Hey, do you want to coach professionally with it? And I was ready to stop traveling when baseball was over for me as a player. And I had my first daughter was 2 when I stopped playing, and my second daughter was born, you know, a couple years after that. And I had come from a family that had been involved in thoroughbred racehorses for a long time, for generations. So I had started my breeding business and been syndicating racehorses for a short period of time. So it was a natural next step for me. Okay. Coaching wasn't the natural next step. But once my second daughter got old enough to sign up for T-ball, you know, we went ahead and did it. And I tried to step back, but I needed to step forward. Mm-hmm. And I really took a lot of pride in seeing these kids improve. And when a kid plays better, whether they perform better in class, they're happy with things and they're just happier in general.
I think the best coaches are the ones that can adapt and adjust to different situations. One of the best coaches that I ever met from this area was Bobby Floyd. Mm-hmm. But, you know, Bobby, you know, helped us in high school, worked with little leaguers. Then he worked with the Mets rookies. Then he was Bobby Valentine's bench coach. And you can just adapt to each thing. I mean, you know, we talked in the car on the way over. I think there's a necessity, and I'm very big on this. I always talk to the FHSAA on this. Coaches have to improve also, just like teachers, because a coach is a teacher. And we should have classes, we should have seminars, not just to tell the coaches the rules. Everybody knows the rules. But how can they be better? You feel that way?
There are so many situations that come up in an athletic event, whether it's between the lines or in the dugout or outside the field, whether dealing with the people, not just the players. Right. You know, there's a person in that uniform, and that person may play shortstop or left field, but it's still a person that has school issues, family issues, things like that. So any coach needs to be able to deal with two sets of things with the players and the people in uniforms. And the person I played for that was really good with that was Joe Torre.
Okay.
He could handle the players, but he also knew how to handle the people in the uniforms. Okay. And again, another situation where I was exposed to somebody who was really good at a particular skill, and I tried to implement that when I coach kids because I understood the difference between being in the uniform and out of it.
Now, how do you think somebody like Joe Torre, who's been around, how do you think he evolved into that? I don't think he was always that way. How did he evolve into such a people person? And when we had Scott Proctor on, he said the same thing, you know, how well Joe related to every single player.
You know, Joe was, you know, a player, a very good player. So everything on the field, Joe had intact. There was no problem there. You know, Joe got a managerial position. You know, I'm going to say, you know, earlier than later, just because it was so long. It was in the early 80s, I think, with the Braves and the Mets and, you know, that. And I think it's a lot of it's experience.
Yeah.
And if you talk to people, whether it's on field, yeah. off the field about on field issues, or yeah. off the field about other stuff. Yeah. The relationships are really what matter through all yeah. this. And if you develop and build a good relationship, you can talk to people about anything and help them with anything.
And I think being a good coach and being a good teacher, you got to be a good listener, because it's got to be a give and take. And you know, I think the days that, well, we're going to do it this way, that's it, that's out. You know, and you look at somebody like Joe Torre, he failed his first few times.
Right.
Bill Belichick failed his first few times.
Thomas Edison failed a lot.
Right. Thank God we got the lights today.
You yes. know?
But people, I mean, they take their failures and they build on it. They don't just hide or run away from it. And you learn. And I think that's what I think we need to emphasize on coaching, because it's a lot different. You know, I know, you know, coaching this year and you know, helping out over at Martin County, and you know, working with, you know, some of the different youth groups, it's different. And you usually want, I always like the kids, tell me what I just tried to teach you. Say it back to me so I know that you understand. You just don't, I guess kids want to know why now.
Certainly, you know, yeah. why, and I think that's, I found that that's more of a girl thing than a boy thing. And having started my right. coaching with young girls right. in softball, right. the why question came out the first practice, and I wasn't quite prepared yeah. for it. And I know the second practice I came out and had a yeah. printed sheet with all the answers
right.
on it,
right.
so that the amount of questions would be minimized.
Right.
But even something as simple right. on a baseball softball field as taking a pitch, you know, I would ask the girl, yeah. I'd give them the take sign, yeah. and they would still swing, and you know, we talk about yeah. afterwards, you know, that meant don't swing. So the next practice, show of hands, who knows what take a pitch means? Only my daughter yeah. raised her hand. Yeah. I said, all right, what do you think it means? She goes, take a swing at it. You know, the other kids, that's what they say, take a big hack.
Yeah.
And yeah. obviously it's the opposite yeah. of
yes.
that. But then yeah. the why came, well, why, coach? Why can't I swing if yeah. it's a strike? Yeah. I said, well, we're having our runner, base runner at first, steal yeah. second
right.
base. If you foul the ball off, they have to go back to yeah. first. And yeah. having that hit me right in the face, the literally practice yeah. number one and game number one, it helped me adapt as
yeah,
a coach
yeah.
to understand yeah. what they were thinking, because yeah. they're not thinking what I'm thinking.
And if you're taking, either in baseball or softball, if you're taking a pitch and the first pitch is a ball, then take the second one, right?
That's just what I would suggest.
I would suggest on that. Your daughter's doing very well playing softball?
My daughter, Scarlett, graduated from Jensen Beach
right.
in 2016
right.
and got an opportunity, a scholarship to go to New York University.
Right.
You know, quite a different environment
yes.
from
yes.
the
yeah.
coastal
okay.
beach town
right.
to the big city. As I tell people, she's the happiest kid in America. She loves being in New York. She loves the academic regimen up there that's nonstop.
It's a very good academic school, right?
Yes, yes.
Yeah.
She's in the College of Nursing up
that's
there.
Great.
It's,
that's great.
Very intense work.
Right. Right.
And softball has to take a second seat to the academics.
Right.
There are times
right.
when many of the girls can't go to practice or miss games
right.
because classes
right.
are scheduled. And the coach works with the
right.
academic department on that. But the kids really respect the coach, because he they know he's under a different set of rules than other institutions, and you know, they've had another successful season.
And we always try to emphasize to all the student athletes how important your academics are, especially in you know, sports other than football. Okay, maybe men's basketball, maybe a little bit women's basketball. You know, we have the football draft coming up this week,
mm-hmm.
and most of those kids have not gone to school second semester if they're leaving early.
Yeah.
But in other sports, baseball, soccer, you know, other sports, if you have your academics, you have an option. If you're a great player or a very good player, you have your options to be drafted. But if you're not drafted where you want to be, you have the option of going back to school. And if I'm not mistaken, baseball would give out very few full scholarships. There was a half scholarship, there's a quarter scholarship, but they could fill it in with academic money.
The journey as a parent of
yeah.
a young athlete
yeah.
now,
yeah.
I have absolutely learned there's more academic scholarship money available
right.
than athletic
right.
money. And it surely seems like
yeah.
so many parents, when they hear the word scholarship, they pivot and that is their complete focus.
Yeah.
And the kids just learn to, all right, if I play better, I get more money. Yet, you know, if you're not exposed to the right coaches and schools, it, you know, 0 times 100 is still zero. You know, you don't get that money. Where your academics, you are in charge of, and you can always find a spot that there are opportunities out there. Schools are going to give you money for your academics, and you can't let that opportunity pass you by.
And we got to be able somehow to explain this to parents that way too, because you know everybody's focused. And another topic we talked on the way over is that as time has gone on, since you know I've been involved in high school athletics almost 40 years now, a little over 40 years, how you used to play 2, 3, some even 4 sports. Now we want to just concentrate on one sport because we think that's where the money is. And it's going to get into a topic we'll talk about in a few minutes that we could have 5 shows on, is the different injuries. But I think parents are focusing on one specific topic now.
Once a parent hears the word scholarship, everything else is out of focus. Okay. And it doesn't matter. Let's say your kid does play 2 or 3 sports.
Right.
Once some coach says, oh, you can get a scholarship, that's it. Everything is off the radar. And that is probably not for the betterment of the kids, whether it's, you know, you're playing a one team, one sport all the time, physically and mentally is probably not the best. And being exposed to the different sports and training your body and letting some parts of your body have a little bit of a rest while you work other parts is probably a better balance.
And different coaches' perspective too. And it's good to give a break. I know when I coach, I told my kids in the fall, find something to do other than baseball. Find something to do, or I'll find something to do for you. Okay? You just go play something else. You know?
That's wise advice. I mean, that's something that, the second year in coaching Jensen Beach baseball, we sort of revamped the whole fall program because the kids have been playing since January.
Right.
And they needed a rest, and they needed to build some strength and raise the level of conditioning, and that meant playing less baseball. And there was some pushback from some of the families saying, well, we want to see more games. Well, we've just been through 8 months of games. So it took a little while, and I've seen some of the other local schools get into more strength and conditioning and a little less focus on the games. You need to see some of the kids play, but it's more like a real professional or college level calendar.
Right. Now the topic that we're going to talk about, and it's been all over the news the last few years, the amount of arm injuries from a pitcher. And you as a pitcher, I know we had Rick Ankiel and Scott Proctor on a few months ago, and we talked about that. And you had mentioned on, you know, before that 25% of the major league pitchers are going to have Tommy John surgery, which is the most serious type of surgery you can have. It knocks everybody out close to a year, is that correct?
Yes, I mean, if they can get the recovery time down to a year, that's very advanced. Okay. It used to be 2 years, then they worked it back to 18 months, and that's through therapy and you know, the changes there. It's but the body still has to heal and then build it back up to put it under the same stress that broke the arm in the first place. So it's a difficult process.
And then we were talking about, we think that, you know, 50 to 60% of the pitchers in the major leagues, now this is the major leagues where they have trainers and doctors there every day, are going on the disabled list for, you know, 10 to 15 games because of injuries like that. So do you think it starts when they were young and builds up?
It seems like it. I think back of, you know, I was talking to my first major league pitching coach, Jim Cott, again, local resident, and he came and spoke to a team that I coached recently, and they asked him about injury, and one time in 25 years did he have a little tweak of the forearm, and it was at the end of a season. He rested over the off season and came back and pitched many, many years. But the key word there was rest. And Jim's a proponent of throwing a lot, but not necessarily everything behind the ball 100% feel like your arm's falling off your body.
And how many years? Jim pitched 25 years
in the major leagues over the course of four decades, starting in 59.
And the great statement that you told me that one of the players asked him that he was giving a seminar to is, how many pitches did you throw at 100%? And what did Jim say?
None.
Which is, and he lasted 25 years, you know. Yep. I know we're emphasizing pitch counts tremendously that, mm-hmm. you know, years ago we never mentioned pitch counts. Do you think that's the major factor, or do you think throwing different types of pitches so early in their career?
Pitch counts are a double-edged sword to me. I know I was coming through an era where there weren't pitch counts.
There was no pitch counts.
With my mechanics in high school, yeah. I threw a lot of pitches. Right. I threw between 120 and 140 pitches every start. Pitched almost seven innings every start in high school, and my arm still feels good to this day. So pitch count wouldn't have made my arm feel any better. I think being under game stress 9 to 12 months a year is what's different on these younger kids. I know in the thoroughbred business, before any young thoroughbred, I'm saying two-year-olds, once they start their training, before they're allowed to breeze fast enough, run fast enough, where you put them on the stopwatch, you have the veterinarian x-ray their knees. And you x-ray the top of the joint and see if the growth plate is closed. Okay. You know, back in the day, it was, $50 an x-ray. And now I hear a lot of 10 and 12-year-old kids having growth plate issues, not just in the elbow, but sometimes in the shoulder.
Now, what would that come from at that age?
It's just immaturity, physical immaturity. It's just their age.
Should they be thrown the breaking pitches, or is it just...
Breaking pitches thrown properly, I don't think, are any problem.
Wow.
But when you throw them improperly, you put extra strain on tendons and ligaments.
Right.
And a 10 and 12-year-old, how strong are they? How strong are their forearm muscles and their tricep and bicep? And, then you get to the high school age and you say to the kids, you have to be stronger. And then they go and do five times the amount of bicep curls because that looks good when they walk by their classmates in the hallways.
Right.
But it doesn't help for baseball. So there's a balance.
Right.
There's always a balance. And getting these kids to sort of and parents to understand that strength and growth is good, but at a reasonable pace, not, we're going to become a 14-year-old strength program within, 11 or 12-year-old's body.
Right. And see, we have maybe the high school coaches trying to put one program in, and then you have outside coaches trying to put another program in, and you can't do two programs at the same time,
It's very tough. We did talk earlier about how you told your high school players, as of January, you're with me, and that's it.
Yeah.
And we ran into that at Jensen Beach where you get into February and March, and the kids are getting pressure to try out for travel teams.
Yeah.
And you know it's gonna happen. So I know we let it happen, but all we did was ask the kids, let us know when you're pitching somewhere else so that we can schedule our workouts accordingly so that you don't do bullpens on back-to-back days because we didn't know it. And I was surprised at the resistance to that. And like, we're only trying to keep your kids sound. And there was pushback.
And then we're forgetting about a very important topic in there. How about your academics? You can't be doing, two different programs and work on your academics, which, the emphasis, it's a lot harder to get that college scholarship now because of the academic rules have increased in the last 20 years. You got to have a fine line there, and you got to work with your academics. I mean, all the years when I was an athletic director, we had many college coaches come in from many different sports. Nobody, not one, and we had Nick Saban in there, we had many, many other coaches, visit us at Centennial and when I was at Pace and Port St. Lucie, and nobody ever asked me about their athletic ability because they have tape. They come to me and they say, can you set up an appointment with the guidance counselor so I can see their grades? And then they would say, John, be honest with me, we got a good kid, good family life. That's what they want to know. And I think we're just so emphasized on the physical athletic aspect that we're forgetting different things. look at the, you know, National Football League draft. And we're hearing one player after the next. We have a domestic violence case. We have failed drug tests. And these guys know they're going to be, you know, they're going to be scrutinized in 2 weeks. You know, sometimes you wonder where their heads are at, you know?
No, there's no question about it. It's a very important issue. And when college coaches have called me regarding some of the local athletes, I don't have to tell them how hard they throw because they've already scouted them.
Right.
I don't have to tell them that their breaking ball is 12 to 6 or 11 to 5 because they've seen that on their own. But they do still, to this day, they want to know what the kid's like in school. You know, can they adapt? You know, let's say you've got a kid that's at a high school with 1,600 students and their college has 40,000 kids. How are they going to adapt?
That's right. And, you know, some of them have never been away from home before, you know? And you know, I always would laugh, like, you know, you bring a parent in and say, geez, we got all these college offers. Well, they're out of state. Well, what do you have in state? Sometimes you're limited, you know? Like, we had some great soccer players over the years, and, you know, college soccer is not gigantic here in Florida, and, you know, or wrestling, which is hardly at all. You say, well, we got this offer out in Minnesota, or we got this offer in Wisconsin. Well, it's kind of far away. Well, you got to learn to adapt. Quick question as we're winding down here. Hardest hitter you ever faced to get out, okay? I'm putting you on the spot here, my friend.
You know, I'm prepared for this. Okay. I've been asked this before.
Okay, good.
Okay, so the trio of Rick Dempsey, Eddie Williams, and John Cangelosi, Miami native, that you should know.
Yes, Miami Springs.
The three of them, I think they were 7 for 10 getting on base, and each of them had a home run.
John hit a home run.
Yes.
Little John, who was 5'8".
Right, right, exactly. Wow. But I always have my backup data where Dale Murphy, Daryl Strawberry, Eddie Murphy, Gary Carter, Mike Schmidt, and I think they were a combined 2 for 25 off.
Isn't that amazing?
So it's funny how the numbers work in baseball.
That's great. And you mentioned John Cangelosi, who I know very well, John. Well, I want to thank you for coming on the show. Hey, Coach, and I know we enjoy working with you together. I just want to send out condolences to a longtime coach and his family, Scott Hoffman, who passed away last month. Scott was a soccer coach at Port St. Lucie in Centennial, and he passed away. He was a great teacher, a great credit here to St. Lucie County, and, you know, we send out his condolences to his family. But I'd like to thank everybody for watching, and we'll see you next month on Hey Coach.